Bueno, pues gracias a todos y a todas por estar hoy aquí en el seminario, uno más del CIO semanal. Y bueno, hoy tenemos la suerte de contar con la presencia, la participación de Magdalena Capelco, que ya es una habitual del CIO. Desafortunadamente no puede visitarnos dadas las circunstancias de manera física y presencial, pero bueno, al menos sí que podemos disfrutar de sus charlas de manera online y virtual. Y bueno, ¿qué decir de Magdalena? Pues que es profesora del Departamento de Logística, y esto siempre lo pronuncio mal, de la Wrocław University of Economic and Business de Polonia. Bueno, tiene más de 40 artículos publicados, un índice H de 10, ha sido investigadora principal de 3 proyectos, ha participado en otros 6 proyectos más a nivel internacional, a nivel nacional. Fue profesora visitante de la Universidad Carlos III de Madrid durante 3 años. Ha realizado varias estancias en diferentes universidades y países, en Holanda, en España, en Estados Unidos, etc. Es especialista en técnicas DEA, que, bueno, que es un método no paramétrico para la estimación de fronteras de producción y su aplicación a diferentes ámbitos. Y hoy en concreto, bueno, pues viene a hablarnos sobre el título de su trabajo es Assessing Corporate Social Responsibility Efficiency for the International Food and Beverage Manufacturing Industry. Yo entiendo que Magda va a dar la charla porque se suele sentir más cómoda en inglés, pero bueno, que sepáis que podéis luego lanzaros a hacer las preguntas en castellano y pues ellos contestarán el idioma que ella quiera. Espero que no sea en polaco al menos, pero... Así que bueno, Magda, muchísimas gracias, como siempre, un placer y adelante.
Thank you very much, Juan, for your nice presentation, and thank you very much for the invitation to give this seminar. Of course, I wish to be now in Elche, but as we know, it's impossible now. But I am happy that we can be together at least virtually. So, as Juan told, the paper I will present is about the construction of composite indicators of firms' activities within the domain of corporate social responsibility. And the focus of this analysis is food and beverage manufacturing industry in different world regions. Well, this is a working paper, and honestly, it's at a very preliminary stage. So, so I really, your comments, your suggestions are very welcome. I would really appreciate them, especially that this is my individual paper. So there was no interaction between co-authors to make the paper better. So really, your feedback is very much appreciated. Okay, so the outline of my presentation, the usual outline. So I have divided my presentation into 5 parts, beginning with the first part, introduction, with the motivation, objective, and contributions of the paper. Then I will present you a method to construct composite indicators, and then I will move to the empirical part, providing you some information about data sets and showing the results, and I will end up with conclusions. So moving to the first part of my presentation, moving to the introduction. So the paper focuses on corporate social responsibility, or on CSR. So, and here on the slide you have the definition of CSR by European Commission, which defines corporate social responsibility as companies voluntarily integrating social and environmental concerns in their business activities and in their relations with stakeholders. So this definition implies that the companies are not only judged by the profits, but also on their impact on social well-being, on the environment. Another implication is that firms have their responsibilities not only for their shareholders, but also for their wider audience of different stakeholders, including customers, suppliers, and so on. Another focus of the paper is food and beverage manufacturing industry. I think that this is quite interesting case to analyze CSR because this industry is facing a lot of CSR related challenges. And here we have some examples of this specific to food and manufacturing industry challenges related with food safety scares, which made the consumers more concerned with food safety. Another challenge is the increased demand for healthier food, so-called healthy food. Another challenge, consumer awareness of the responsible consumption, for example, of the responsible sourcing, etc. Of course, food and beverage manufacturing industry is also facing more general CSR challenges that could apply to all sectors, such as water and energy efficiency, safety at the workplace, etc. Okay, so these are the main two concerns of the paper. And CSR is a very broad concept. It includes lots of different activities. So that is why there are lots of metrics, lots of indicators that measure CSR. And one of the major challenges in the research on CSR is how to aggregate these different indicators, different metrics to get the overall performance in terms of CSR in order to get the so-called composite indicator of CSR. And there are lots of methods of aggregation that we can find in the literature. And one of the methods that I focus this paper on is a method which is based on data development analysis. It's based on DEA, and it's called Benefit of the Doubt (BOD) model, which was formally introduced into the literature in 2004 in the paper by Cherche. Later on, I will tell in details about this method, about Benefit of the Doubt model, which is used in this paper. Okay, so now looking at the literature. We could look at the literature that the specific CSR literature that uses this BOD model to with the purpose of aggregation CSR indicators, CSR scores into this composite overall measure of CSR performance. And there are not so many papers that use this approach. Here you on this slide, these papers are listed. So there is, for example, Chen and Delmas 2011, which focus on US companies, Bellu and Manescu, which focuses on large companies listed on the main international stock exchanges. We have also one paper with Huan on these issues, where we provide some extension of this BOD model, and we applied it also to the US companies in different sectors. So these are more general studies, which concern different sectors. And there are also some specific studies focusing on food and beverage manufacturing. So this is the study of Engida et al. 2018, which uses the BOD model to aggregate CSR scores for firms, for these food and manufacturing firms in Europe. And again, we have another paper with Juan and also with Juan Francisco Monge, the recent paper from 2020, when we also proposed some extension of BOD model, and we applied it also to the CSR activities of food and beverage manufacturing firms in Europe. So looking at this literature that uses BOT model in the context of CSR, we are reaching the first limitation of the previous studies, because we can observe that none of the previous studies so far computed the CSR composite scores for the international food and beverage manufacturing industry. International, I mean that we so far no study compared this CSR composite indicators for firms in different, for food and manufacturing firms in different regions of the world. So this is the first limitation of previous studies. And now, when I look at the second strand of literature, when I look at specifically at different BOD models, benefit of the doubt models, so this literature is really rich. There are lots of different studies. And here you have some examples listed on how the change, what methodological changes were proposed in the BOD model. So that changes, that proposals includes, for example, the non-radial model that takes into account the possible existence of slugs, the multiplier layer model that considers a hierarchical structure of indicators, the directional model to recognize the preference structures, the directional model that allows dealing with undesirable outputs, the robust and non-compassionary composite indicator, and more, the robust composite indicator with a directional model setting, the composite indicator with imprecise data, the robust BOD model that considers external factors, and these two papers that I mentioned previously that we have with one with Juan and the second one with Juan and Juan Francisco, where we propose two extension. The first one is a translation invariant directional distance function BOD model, and the second one is the BOD model based on the least distance to the frontier. So this is the short summary of this wide, really wide and extensive literature that proposes lots of different modifications in the standard, in the classical BOD model. And in this way, by reviewing this literature, I am reaching the, we can reach the second limitation of the previous literature. So what I have noticed, to the best of my knowledge, all of these previous BOD developments assumed convexity. So the points on the frontier used to evaluate observations are linear combinations of actual data points of actual producer and not the actual producers themselves. That of course can have some perhaps even negative implication for practice, because we are comparing ourselves with fictitious producers and not the actual producers. So in many practical situations, non-convexity would be more suitable. And the most widely applied among all the non-convex envelopment models, the most widely applied is free disposal Hull model, FDH model. As far as I have seen in the literature, this FDH approach has so far never been considered in the context of composite indicators constructed by BOD model. So this is the second limitation of the previous literature. So summarizing this introduction, the aim of this paper is to construct composite measures of CSR from efficiency perspective using BOD model with non-convex structure for a sample of international food and beverage manufacturing firms. So the study, given the limitations that I have introduced The study could have two contributions. So it could be a first study to analyze and compare efficiency in CSR of food and beverage companies across world regions. And methodologically, some small modification is proposed, an extension in the measurement of BOD model, allowing for non-convexities in the production set. Okay, so this is the mainly the motivation and the objective of the study. So moving now to the second part of my presentation about the method use. So before showing you the model, I would like to introduce you a little bit to the the concept of composite indicators and the construction of composite indicators using BOD model. So we could say that in the recent years there is increasing interest in the issue of composite indicators. There are there's a growing literature on that applies composite indicators, especially in different policy-oriented purposes. The idea of composite indicators is very simple, because we what we want to gain is to we want to aggregate a set of sub-indicators into the overall composite measures of performance. And methodologically, how to do it? There are, of course, many different options, beginning with the easiest one, the treating all indicators equally, equal weighting. Of course, a lot of disadvantages of this kind of aggregation could be found. So the later proposals include already accounting for weights. So this proposal began with the usage of arithmetic weighted averages. So recently this method was criticized, and instead of this method, the geometric weighted average was proposed. So in general, the idea that the weights are important in the aggregation is here the main idea. So how the weights are found, how the weights are computed. So there are also lots of options within this literature on how to compute weights, including regression models, different, a little bit subjective judgment by experts, by public opinion, using or using analytic hierarchy process method, and many other methods can be found in the literature. And one of the options considered is also already mentioned BOD model based on data envelopment analysis, which allows to derive objective weights for the indicators, and allows the aggregation of these indicators into the composite overall indicator. And looking specifically at the CSR literature on the corporate social responsibility, here there are also all these different methodologies that now I mentioned, that they also appear within CSR literature, so that the studies use simple summing of scores. They use net scores when we have positive scores and negative scores. They compute kind of net score. They use weighted scores, invoking the opinion of expert. And of course, CSR, as I already mentioned, also CSR literature also uses BOD model. Okay, so let's now look into more details into BOD model. So as I mentioned already, the BOD model was first coined in 2004 in the paper by Church et al. But in fact, the similar model can be found in the efficiency literature quite years earlier in the papers by Lowell and Pastor already in 1997. they formulated DA model without inputs. Later on, I will show the link between both BOD model and the model without inputs of Lowell and Pastor. So the main problem that this BOD model deals with is the it allows to compute weights for sub indicators. The weights are the derived weights are based on the data itself. So these are the objective weights. And the basic idea of composite indicator is to compare the firm sub indicator data between firms and derive the optimal weights for each firm such that the firm is evaluated in the best possible way relative to other firms. Okay, so this is the summary of BOD model, and now going into details, going into models. So this is the model, easy model of Cherche et al., the initial BOD model. So in this model, Y corresponds to the value of the output, and W indicates weight. So in this model, we want to find weights that maximize the composite indicators, and the constraint somehow forces the frontier. It forces the value of objective function of the composite indicators are lower or equal than one. So if the firm is on the frontier, it will have the value of the composite indicator equal to one, and that there won't be firms that are that are scoring better on this weighted sum. Even with the most favorable weights, and the values lower than one will indicate underperformance. So even with the most favorable weights, the firm in question will have lower values, lower than one values of this weighted sum of the objective function. Okay, so this is this basic model, and now my idea was to apply to this model to make it non-convex. So at the first, what is also important to mention when we look at this model, in fact, this is the multiplier version of DEA model. Of input-oriented DEA model in constant returns to scale. So this is important to mention that this is the multiplier version. So wanted to make it FDH model, non-convex FDH model, seems to be easy if we want to do it, but in fact, it is not that easy. At least from my perspective of my background. Because making it FDH implies mixed integer programming. And I was searching the literature, efficiency literature, and in fact, I haven't found any study that that shows the multiplier model for FDH approach. In fact, I even have written it down somewhere what the papers say or what the books say. Somehow the subject of multiplier FDH model is somehow avoided in the literature. So they even, in some papers, they say that duality theory is more complicated in the context of mixed integer problems. So somehow no one shows the multiplier problem for FDH model. So to be honest, I still haven't, still don't have the exact solution for this version. For you, it might be, I guess it might be something obvious to do. For me, it is more tricky. So I still have to read about duality for mixed integer programming. For linear programming, is more obvious. For mixed integer, maybe it's also trivial. I don't know. I haven't seen looked into this literature. So I was only thinking somehow generally intuitively about this FDH version of this multiplier program that I have shown here. So looking a little bit how it is in the linear programming and trying to restrict the constraint into the dominating fields and this that dominate. So this is for me still one big question mark that I'm still working on. This I still have to look for the duality for mixed integer programming. So this is that something that I'm still working on. So the final model, if I want to get from this model to the final model, FDH model in this multiplier form, I still have to work on it. So I tried to approach the problem differently to get the solution, no? To get the solution. So the program by Church et al. Well, it is maybe obvious, but it was also shown recently in 2018 by Van Puyenbroek. They show that the BOD model of Cherche is the reciprocal of the output-oriented VRS model without inputs of Lowell and Pastor. What I have mentioned some minutes ago, that the similar model, that there's similarities with the model between BOD and the model without inputs of Lowell and Pastor. So it is somehow easy to show that one and the other model is the reciprocal of each other. So this is the model, VRS, output-oriented VRS model without inputs of Lower and Pastor. So as we can see, it's a very simple model, just that we don't have inputs here. So we have, like in the composite indicator, no, we have only the output indicators and the single input indicator equal to one for all units. So now we don't need the duality theory. Now it is easy to impose non-convexity, to relax convexity in this model, to make this model FDH, because it's just adding the constraint that the weights, that lambdas, are constrained to be valent. So when I compute such model and I take reciprocal of this model, I am reaching what was the aim of my of the methodological part of this paper, to compute FDH BOD model. So the part of the methodology, I still have to work on it, because I think that it could add more value looking at the multiplier version, but approaching it differently, the solution is very easy. That's just additional constraint, mixed integer programming, and it's the solution can be obtained easily. Okay, so this was the general introduction to the method. I show you also the models. So now let me also show you the graphical explanation of the concept developed. So we are now in the area of composite indicators. So in this graph, I assume, we are in the context of CSR, that we have two sub-indicators, some kind of CSR sub-indicators of Y1 and Y2. And on this graph, I see both convex frontier and FDH frontier with this staircase shape. So here, what I can see, first of all, I can clearly see what means convexity by looking at the point B, which is efficient in the non-convex in the non-convex approach. and it's inefficient in assuming convexity. Looking at the FDH staircase frontier, I see that three units are efficient, A, B, C. A and C are in this example they are efficient by default. B is efficient because it dominates unit D, so we have this inefficient unit D that in the FDH approach is compared to unit is projected to the point D prime. And for unit D, the unique role model is unit B, but when I assume convexity, my point of projection is unit D prime, prime B's, which is here we don't have the unique role model. This is the linear combination of units A and C. So in this example, we, in the context of composite indicators, assuming two indicators, we can see the basic easy idea, and the difference between convex model and FDH model. Okay, so this is almost all regarding methodology. So the final issue about the method that I used is that I have the data on different regions. One of my objectives was to compare a firm's CSR activity, CSR indicators between different regions. So to make it appropriately, I need a special method within it. So I applied the meta-frontier concept. There are also alternative methods to do it. I have chosen meta-frontier. So basically what I did is I estimate my composite indicators. Firstly, I estimated with regard to all firms in the sample. Then I made the estimation for each region separately. And then I computed the residual. So in this way, I have this decomposition of meta-frontier CSR indicator into region-specific indicator and regional CSR gap. So the first indicator measures how close a firm is operating to the region-specific frontier, and the second one measures the how close is region-specific frontier to the meta-frontier. So this is the final issue about the method. So now I can move finally to the empirical part. So the data sets I used is a Sustainalytics data set. So it has, compared to other CSR data sets, it has one advantage which served the purpose of my study. It is not restricted to any geographical region. So it is international data sets of different countries, different regions. I focus on firms in food and beverage manufacturing industry. I try to aggregate three different indicators of CSR. And these are in general three main indicators in general of CSR. This is the environmental CSR, social CSR, and governance CSR. I have the data sets from 2011 to 2018. And I have four regions. So I have Europe, the second region. This regional classification follows the Sustainalytics. So the second region is United States and Canada. The third one, Latin American and Caribbean, and Asia Pacific region. So with these data sets, I computed the composite indicators. Now I can show you the results, but before showing you composite indicators, that the paper talks so much about convexity versus non-convexity. So in the first step of my analysis, I applied the convexity test to see if my data sets is better for applying non-convex approach. So it's quite a recent test by Simar and Wilson from 2020. In this test, the null hypothesis is convexity. So the null hypothesis states that both VRS and FDH approach are reliable, are consistent. And the alternative says that only FDH approach is consistent. So with my, so these are the results of the test. This is for only one part of the results of the test for the meta frontier, where I treat all regions together. So this test does not reject convexity in 2011, 2014, 2015, and 2017, but it rejects convexity in 2012, 2013, 2016, and 2018. So with these data sets, the results are mixed. No, I would personally be more happy to get the rejection of convexity for all years to show more difference between both approaches, but this is what I get. But still, there is evidence of non-convexity, at least for these 4 years. So so for these data sets, the FDH approach could be more appropriate. So applying the FDH approach, the composite indicators, the first table shows the composite indicators. These are geometric averages for meta frontier, where all firms are treated together regardless of the region. And you have the results, this average results for all periods, and also the overall results for 2011-2018. So I see that overall my composite indicators for CSR is equal to 0.777. So the potential to increase CSR output in this sample is around 23%, with the most efficient region being Latin America and Caribbean, and the least efficient being Asia Pacific. So this scores range from 0.7 to 0.85. And looking at the evolution during years, so we see some fluctuations, not large fluctuations, and we see some increase in 2018 of efficiency. So this is the meta frontier. Now let me look at the decomposition into the region specific frontier. The first one, the first table. So we see this composite indicator with regard to each region, so-called, what is called in the literature, managerial efficiency. So we see similarly to the meta frontier that the most efficient is Latin America and Caribbean, and the least efficient is Asia Pacific. So the best results on the management of CSR is obtained by Latin American countries, and the most inefficiency related with the shortcomings in managerial practices with regard to CSR we observe in Asia Pacific. So this is the first component of meta frontier, and the second component is the regional gap. So we see the values of regional gap if we look overall 2011-2018. We see the largest values for Europe, 0.99, and the smallest again for Asia Pacific, 0.86. So we can conclude that European firms that they could increase their increase in CSR output is 99% of this output that could be achieved within meta frontier. On the contrary, Asia Pacific is only CSR output is only 80 almost 87% of that output that could be achieved within Meta Frontier. Of course, I still need to look at the interpretation, more specific interpretation of the results in the context of the industry. So this is the decomposition, the final decomposition. Of course, I have shown you all these numbers, but of course, the important is the statistical significance between indicators, between if really the indicators are statistically significant between regions. So I applied Simar and Zeleniuk tests, and the tests show that the results, the differences between regions are indeed statistically significant. For all three indicators, for meta frontier, region specific frontier, and regional gap. And the final result, I made a table where I compare different indicators. So I have the FDH indicator that I already shown in the previous tables for meta frontier for different regions, and I also include in this table VRS indicator, the one that assumes convexity. And I also here included the score that Sistanalytics, that the data set itself provides for, that could be computed based on Sistanalytics, because they provide also the final score for each firm in the sample or on the CSR based on the weighted average. So, of course, the results of Sustainalytics cannot be compared in magnitude between FDH and VRS, but we can perhaps look at the ranking. So, so looking at this, the results, I would be happy to obtain more differences. Now, unfortunately, this data set shows very small differences. First of all, between FDH and between convex approach, VRS approach, small results. But in fact, I have seen it already using convexity tests, no, which shows that not always convexity was rejected. So we could expect such small differences between both approaches, but still they are presented. And looking at Sustainalytics, looking at the ranking, also, the ranking is the same, no? Meaning that the best performing in terms of CSR would be Latin American Caribbean region, and the worst performing would be Asia Pacific. So, but these are the results, no? This is what I get with these data sets. Of course, I would be happier to get more different results to show the differences between all these approaches, but this is what I get. Okay, so these are all results and all the most important things what I wanted to tell. So moving to the conclusions. So in the paper, I analyzed the performance of food and beverage manufacturing firms with regard to CSR over the period 2011-2018. So the study have two sorts kind of contributions. So to differentiate from previous research, I analyzed CSR of food and manufacturing in the, industry in different world regions. And I try to modify it, but still it is in the process, an original BOD model to obtain the FDH-based BOD model. So with these two contributions, with these data sets, with this modification, I found considerable potential for improvement in CSR practices. And the differences between regions that I just have shown you, the differences in CSR efficiency between regions. And future research, well, so there is a lot to do. This paper is at a very preliminary stage. So I have a lot of things to do. The first of all, to get the multiplier form for FDH approach in the context of BOD model. Then, of course, I need to look to try to explain my findings, you know, why I have the differences between the regions, why Latin America scores the best, why Asia Pacific scores the worst. So I have to look into details, into literature on food, on CSR in food and beverage manufacturing in different regions to try to explain this, all these findings. And of course, there are also other ideas, other things to do, like applications of ranking methods, other extensions of BOD model, the CSR. These are scores, these are very specific variables, so this kind of extension, I could think also of another extension to account for the fact that CSR scores are, these are scores, no, these are not the these are specific variables. Another option is also to use, I use MetaFrontier to compare the composite indicators between regions. But of course, there are also other methodologies that are possible for assessing these differences. So this is also the potential avenue for future research to look for other methods for the comparison. Okay, so that concludes my talk. Thank you very much for your attention. Of course, I will be happy to answer your questions, to listen to your suggestions. Pues muchas gracias por estar conmigo, por su atención. Bueno, pues entonces, claro que puedo intentar coger preguntas y responder en español. Sí. Estoy sin hablar un año, pero claro que puedo intentar.
Bueno, pues muchas gracias a Magda. Veo que Juan se activa el micro, supongo que quiere preguntar ya.
Bueno, pues nada, pues muchísimas gracias en primer lugar por el trabajo, por compartir con nosotros estas nuevas ideas frescas.
Bueno, gracias a vosotros, no sé si muy, muy, pero bueno, unas ideas.
Y bueno, siempre me sorprende que hay tantísimo escrito sobre composición de indicadores y siguen habiendo todavía la posibilidad de abrirse caminos nuevos, como el que ha propuesto hoy Magda. Así que me parece siempre sorprendente, pero excelente a la vez, ¿no? Y bueno, a ver, preguntas como tal.
Cada vez es más difícil, cada vez más difícil, yo creo que.
Ya. Sí, claro. Pero la verdad es que se ha escrito mucho sobre esto. O sea, sí. Bueno, de hecho, hay revistas que están casi especializadas en estos asuntos, ¿eh? Sí. Y bueno, como pregunta, bueno, pues preguntarte como experta que has usado muchas veces estas técnicas para crear, bueno, composición de, para componer indicadores, ¿no? ¿Cómo es importante el tema de estudiar la robustez? La robustez al uso de los datos, porque al final las bases de datos son imperfectas. Tú lo sabes bien, son imperfectas. Te faltan empresas que deberían estar, pero claro, no publican sus datos. Hay mil circunstancias que hacen que las bases de datos no sean perfectas. Por lo tanto, ¿cómo es de importante la robustez de los resultados con respecto al manejo de datos y de variables? Bueno, se tienen los indicadores que publican ciertas compañías especializadas en recopilar información de este tipo o ciertos organismos públicos, pero en fin, no están todas las variables que a lo mejor uno desearía tener. ¿Cómo es importante el tema de la robustez en estas cuestiones?
Bueno, yo creo que sí que es muy importante, ¿no? Y creo que algunos approaches de este BOD model, ¿no? Que hay ya metodologías incluso hechas que en alguna manera están tomando en cuenta, bueno, al menos en algún porcentaje, la robustez, ¿no? Porque, por ejemplo, hay, si yo miro la revisión de literatura, en este ámbito de BOD model, por ejemplo, hay indicadores que se llaman, hay propuestas de indicadores estos robustos, ¿no? Que entonces sí que hay, ya hay algunos intentos de tomar en cuenta robustez, pero yo creo que en este ámbito que todavía se podría incluso pensar en algunas metodologías, en algunas extensiones más, que tal vez aquí hay lugar para proponer todavía algo nuevo. Pero creo que el tema bueno, es muy importante y en alguna manera ya está en la literatura tomando en cuenta.
Gracias. Bueno. Sí, 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 gracias, gracias. Y más preguntas. Claro, haces uso de, bueno, de FDH IDEA, pero bueno, la metodología, digamos, la parte novedosa está en el uso del FDH. Si vamos a Google Scholar y miramos referencias sobre DEA y referencias sobre FDH, pues de DEA hay, no sé, 25.000 y de FDH vas a encontrar 5.000. Es decir, a la hora de publicar, digamos, es más interesante, si continúa siendo más interesante el DEA que el FDH. ¿O tú crees que no? ¿Tú crees que está cogiendo un cierto empuje, una cierta fuerza en los últimos años, por lo que ves en los congresos, publicaciones y demás? Por ejemplo, Kerstens, que he citado, sé que sí. Está ahí, está el hombre sí. intentando convencer al mundo entero, ¿no? Sí. Spread the word, porque está intentando el hombre siempre evangelizar con respecto al uso del FDH. No sé si lo consigue del todo. A mí mismo me he mandado algunos emails al respecto. ¿Qué piensas tú?
Bueno, además de Kerstens, bueno, creo que hay más, ¿no? Que, bueno, de verdad que ya un año estamos sin congresos, ¿no? Prácticamente es una cosa. Pero en los últimos que estuvimos sí que se veía, ¿no? Papers con FDH. Yo creo que tú, Juan, ¿no? Ahora con Miriam, el primer paper, ¿no? De Asterink, sí. ¿No? Es también regresar un poquito al, bueno, la mejoramiento de FDH, ¿no? Entonces.
Sí, 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 es cierto.
Que también sois vosotros que también abréis de nuevo el interés en FDH.
Sí. Bueno, sí, sí, pero, sí, sí, sí. Bueno, y hay más autores, ¿no?
Hay más, hay algún interés, bueno, además de Kerstens, ¿no? De, que, bueno, que hay ahora papers, ¿no? De Simar y Wilson que ya permiten, que ellos mismos también, ¿no? Que la gente sí. Fuerte, Simar y Wilson dicen que, cuidado, ¿no? Que no, que Convexity es muy fuerte, que
sí, bueno. Sí, claro, porque al final él es... Sí, sí. Suponer convexidad sobre la tecnología es suponer concavidad de la función de producción y eso tiene, digamos, una repercusión sobre los rendimientos a escala que se asumen en producción. Mientras que evitar la suposición de convexidad, utilizar modelos FDH, pues permitiría estimar funciones de producción bajo rendimientos a escala de muy diferente naturaleza. O sea, que es verdad que hay muchísima más flexibilidad en el caso de asumir tecnología no convexa. O sea, que desde luego hay ventajas en el uso del FDH. Y tal vez inconvenientes en la parte computacional o a la hora de escribir los modelos, ¿no? O la dificultad de obtener ese dual, etcétera, ¿no? Vale. ¿Alguna reflexión más? Tú que conoces la literatura sobre composición de indicadores y uso de técnicas como DEA, etcétera, ¿no? Benefit of doubt, ¿no? Usando técnicas DEA. ¿Te suena que hagan uso de técnicas más allá de lo puramente descriptivo? Porque al final el uso de FDH y DEA, digamos que son metodologías sobreajustadas, se ajustan como un guante perfecto, ¿no? a una mano, que en este caso es tu nube de puntos, cumpliendo una serie de propiedades, ¿no? En el caso de FDH simplemente free disposability y poco más. ¿Te suena que exista también, bueno, pues digamos la necesidad o han usado metodologías que te permitan pasar de lo puramente descriptivo a, digámoslo, a lo inferencial, a lo poblacional, no solo la muestra, dar el salto a lo poblacional? ¿Te suena? Quiero decir, al final tú tienes una muestra de empresas, pero la tecnología de verdad, o sea, digamos que esta muestra de empresas debería permitirte estimar la tecnología más allá de lo puramente descriptivo. Decirte algo sobre la función de producción, vamos a decirlo así, teórica, que generó de verdad los datos. ¿Eso te suena? Pasar de lo meramente descriptivo a lo inferencial.
Yo creo que además de Bootstrap, no hay nada más, ¿no? que...
¿Ya han usado, bueno, han usado Bootstrap en estas, en estos...?
Bootstrap sí, Bootstrap sí. Seguro que Bootstrap y Composite Indicator sí que lo he visto, sí, el Bootstrap. Pero además de Bootstrap...
Vale.
Bueno, no he visto. Pero claro, hay que mirarlo porque claro que aparecen nuevos papers, pero no. Entonces sí que vosotros, ¿no? Con la... el Efficiency, bueno, Analysis...
Nosotros lo estamos intentando, sí, por eso pregunto.
Solamente el Bootstrap. Bootstrap sí. Bootstrap seguro que en muchos, porque el Bootstrap con Composite Indicators está en FIR, ¿no? De CIMAR, de Wilson, sí, en el package. Entonces la gente lo ha utilizado, ¿no? Porque es fácil,
claro,
aplicarlo, porque está ya el listo. Paquete.
Sí.
Hacerlo. Entonces, Bootstrap sí, pero además de Bootstrap, no, yo creo que nada, ¿no? Entonces sí que hay cosas para hacer en este ámbito.
Y ya por último. Claro, hablabas de uso de otros métodos alternativos a las metafronteras. Claro, el problema de la metafrontera, a ver, es maravilloso el poder descomponer en ineficiencias, digamos, debidas a tu frontera país, por decirlo así, y la distancia a una superfrontera, metafrontera, ¿no? Generada con todos los datos. Pero claro, esa función de producción que se genera con todos los datos no necesariamente es real. ¿De acuerdo? Esto Daniel Santín, que tú lo conoces, pone un ejemplo a veces, donde sí que se puede visualizar esa frontera, esa metafrontera, dice. Dice, en la NBA, cada equipo que tiene sus jugadores más o menos brillantes, sería cada país, por decirlo así. En el All-Star que se juega en la NBA, eligen a los mejores de cada equipo y los ves jugar. Entonces, ahí sí que estás viendo la metafrontera de verdad, aunque solo sea un día. Pero eso en general no pasa. Cada uno compite en su región o compite pues, en su mercado. Entonces, la metafrontera tiene ese problema, que realmente no es real. Esa distancia, ese gap que se calcula, pues no resulta real, ¿de acuerdo?
Ajá,
que veo a esto de las metafronteras. Existen otras técnicas, como tú dices. Yo la que te sugiero es, pues, a la hora de comparar unidades, DMUs, empresas por países, pues utilizar el índice de tamaño Dyson, por ejemplo, si permite hacer ese tipo de comparaciones sin tener que crear una metafrontera.
Pero este para productividad, ¿no? ¿O?
No, para comparar el performance, digamos, entre unidades, entre grupos de unidades. Lo que pasa es que utiliza, eso sí que es verdad, es un poco extraño porque, bueno, extraño, tiene todo el sentido del mundo si se lee con detalle, ¿no? Utiliza el índice de Malquist. Construye un índice de Malquist que permite comparar entre grupos de unidades. Pero bueno, eso no tenía que ser tan raro, porque realmente el índice de Malquist se puede utilizar para comparar unidades en un momento de tiempo determinado o para comparar una unidad en distintos momentos de tiempo. O sea, que esas posibilidades existen en literatura si digamos que Camaño y Dyson explotaron una de ellas, ¿no? Entonces, bueno, yo mi sugerencia, ¿no? Como opciones seguro que hay más. Pero una de ellas, desde luego, es el índice de Camaño Dyson. Y nada más. No sé si hay alguna pregunta en el chat. Bueno, pues, Mata, lo dicho, muchísimas gracias, de verdad.
Muchas gracias a vosotros.
Bueno, pues, muchísimas gracias a todos, especialmente a Mata, y a ver si aquí para verano puedes venir un poco y desconectar. Muchas gracias. Hasta luego. Chao.